So, hi and welcome everyone to this GrafanaCon online talk. Welcome for myself as well, because that's my first time attending a Grafana conference. This talk shall show some like nice things one can do with Grafana, or we did within the context of beam monitoring and comparison of particulate matter readings, and like giving one focus on the beauty of the one side, but on like more advanced querying solutions on the other side, how to compare readings from different networks, find the reading of the closest reading in another network, and how to do live compensation, correcting things within a Grafana dashboard. So let's have a short look at the table of contents. First part is about the B weather. So first, it's very first, we will talk about the weather itself, and what a meteorogram is, and how one can create a meteorogram in Grafana, which combines past and future. Then we are taking a look at the Bs, and on the one hand, what are the conditions of the Bs in terms of weather, and what can we monitor on Bs, and how to bring that together in like the weather forecast for the bees. In the second part, we are going to the particulate matter subject, which is mainly about the correlation or comparison of official and semi-official stations, and the correction with other factors like humidity. So, but before talking about the weather, a short note about myself. In my very childhood, I was very enthusiastic about meteorology and weather forecasting. Then I did very much graphic design stuff and ended, but IT-wise, in the IT networking world. And there, I had the question: how does the weather affect our wireless links? Our wireless point-to-point links, and I started importing weather data into our monitoring solution, and friends of mine noticed that and said, hey, we are within this Hive-Eyes project, where we develop open source hardware and software for monitoring beehives for beekeepers. And I found that very interesting. Things got together and evolved from there. So this is a meteorogram, a traditional look at weather data. Here, these are forecast meteorogram, where we can see how weather will evolve in the next time, and it's a bunch of graphs showing the different elements. It's more or less two times the same data in different representations. Left is from the National Weather Service of the US, and right is a German private representation. And you see in the top we have the clouds, and then we have the air pressure and the winds and temperatures and humidities and rainfall. And I thought that must be quite easy to represent within Grafana, and that's like the first catch of like the imported stuff. And we see here the amount of cloud cover in different heights, and for that I use the discrete plugin for Nethel Energy, what was quite nice. And so I'm just looking up the value and coloring and the color a cloud normally has. And we used like the discrete plugin too for creating these wind arrows, where we can maybe just match like the ranges the wind direction can take here in the circle from 0 to 360 degree, and then mapping them to just UTF-8 arrows. And there's a bunch of arrows because I don't know in which zoom intensity you will look at that. So it's a bit ugly while hovering, but in the end you have a nice view on the wind direction of a whole time frame. So let's continue. I wanted to combine the past and the future, because normally one sees only the one of these two, and I think it makes more sense because we have the last 2 days, for example, in your guts. You know how it was, and you can easily create a relationship to what the graphs will say about the near future. So there were two challenges I'd like to address. The first was a bit unforeseen. There were no common station IDs within both worlds. So I had to create manually a list for which mapped all the station pairs, I think, which belong together. And so we can use this list to look up the IDs we want to query later on to get the effective data. And I call this practice nesting of dashboard templating variables. So we have a first variable called common CDC name, which is polluted by this one big list I created by the simple, more readable name. I haven't decided to take the uppercase name, but the lowercase. And then after this variable is picked with some value, the other two queries for the IDs work again and now put out the ID of the relevant network. So the query looks for the second variable a bit like this, where we just use the result of the first query variable to query the ID of the other network. So and then we can use that to query the data itself. So we have here two data tables, or here a graph, which shows here the right current now position and the readings from the past and the forecast from the future. So that's like the basic principle for querying this stuff. Then the other challenge was about units, but that's easily to accomplish because like every unit has its equation in the other unit, and when querying our database, we doing that calculations already within the query. So InfluxDB is our data horse here, does the calculation. I've just heard that Grafana 7 will do that kind of data transformation on a higher level between series. I'm very cu curious about that. So that's in the end the whole compilation in one meteogram, which shows you like the elements. Let's go to a station which has a bit more in the past. Not everything is recorded at every station. Here we have the sun too and the cloud cover again. We see that we are currently in some rain, which will end. The temperatures have dropped very much, and it will take several days before we are reaching somewhere nearly 20 degrees again. Then we have here the humidity and the chances of rain in the future, the wind speed and the pressure. For the pressure, we have a small special problem because the pressure is on the one hand for the past recorded at the level of the station, the height of the station above zero, and the prediction is only for sea level, so we have to recalculate that. Therefore, we are querying our metadata with another variable for the station height, and we can use that value itself within querying our new results. Just show it to you. Here it's still normal influx query, and we are here using our variable with the height divided by 8 to get our new position so that these two belong together. This only works on low levels. If you go to the highest point we have in Germany, the Zugspitze, we see this calculation won't match anymore. It has to be a better formula, but in principle, it's something. There's no pressure. There's no pressure recorded too. Yeah, here it fits again better. So that's for the meteogram. You just use new stations. I want to make some advertisement for Andreas' developments in the map panel plugin. He made like an auto zoom to the selected data set, so we can just change the station here again, and this whole panel zooms to or scrolls to the new position, or we can use a click here to reload the dashboard with a new station. So now let's talk a bit more about the bees, and what is my time? Yeah, only 10. The bee monitoring is itself not only a hobby, because like the beekeeper is tended not to inspect his hive that often, because every inspection of a hive is like a big cut within the living of a colony, and therefore this inspection has to be kept at a very low rate. And what we can measure with the data doesn't substitute a full inspection, but the idea is to have the amount of inspections necessary as low as possible. That's good for the bees and, of course, good for the beekeeper too. So let's talk about the elements we are currently measuring and what they can probably indicate, which means especially weight and temperature. And when we look at the weight, we see in the background here a scale. In the center is a sensor for the scale, and on the scale frame you put the whole hive, the box with the bees on it. So, and when weighing your bees, you can see easily is nectar or pollen collected, or is it getting eaten because it's winter and there's nothing out. You can see the drying of nectar because it's very wet in the beginning and got dried within the hive. In winter, you as a beekeeper, you can see will the feed last until spring, because you're taking out honey, you have to leave something there or substitute it, and does the feed last until the summer starts again. You can control more easily the size of your or the population of your bees, because the population itself is expanding in the summer and getting lower in the winter. And if you need to control like your hive size, that they don't swarm, what would be the natural way of reproduction of the bees. And that's something the human likes to control. But if that doesn't work out, you can use the hive's weight to get an alarm if a swarm has taken off, because the beekeeper is always interested in catching again his swarms. You can detect if honey flow stalls, maybe some fruits or crops aren't available at some times or disappear suddenly due to weather events. You can plan your harvest, and when you can see now fruit time is over, now it's the perfect time to catch the honey. And of course, you can detect theft or other bad place with your hive. So that's the installed scale under a hive. And that's an idea of a swarm event, where you can see we have like more than 50 kilograms, and in the very next moment, like this is 50, this is 12 minutes later, 3 kilograms of bees, like more than 3,000 bees have left the premises, and it was just recorded some days ago. So here you could see the hive of the weight graph of an untouched hive within during summer. You see there are bad days and good days. We see in the background like the daily amount of weight difference. These are two queries, or both filtered above zero or below zero, so I can color these in two different types. And we can see like the increases and sudden decreases every time, like a zigsaw. This is the moment where nectar got dried overnight and nothing new gets in. So you will see that in a bit again and go into more details. So, but first let's talk about the temperatures. When it's 35 degrees more or less within the hive, you can indicate from that there must be a brood, because a brood is always kept at 35 degrees, and whereas brood there must be a queen. A queen is really necessary for the bee population staying alive. And if you use multiple thermometers within different positions as an array within scale, you can see where the brood nest in winter, the bees gather together due to the coldness outside, where this is located. And you can plan medical treatment, because some medication needs to be applied when there is no brood anymore, so this can be planned good. So that's about the things we monitor about the bees and what we can learn from that about how the bees are right now. To see how the weather has an influence on the bees, there were some studies done by our weather service, which basically say bees need enough temperature and sun to go out and fly, and there doesn't need to be too much wind or rain so that they do. So we are using that now to combine all our measurements into this look of, sorry, the beehive weather dashboard. So we see again here, now zoomed out to the complete year, our untouched beehive. There are no, normally we would see spikes within that when the beekeeper adds some boxes or removes honey. This is a complete untouched hive. And we see good and bad times in summer, and we see a sudden stop, which is normal when of the collecting of nectar and pollen, and the bees are only living now the rest of the year from what they have collected so far. And we see a sudden decrease in the weight that indicates that this colony died in the end of the year. On the left, we see the boom table, which is quite nice to give a short overview on the current readings. It allows to do some analysis too, so we can color these icons in green or red if they are like good or bad. On the right, you see the temperature and humidities inside and outside, and that's fascinating on the temperature that you see the outside temperature going up and down the whole year while these 35 degrees are kept within the hive on a very steady level, and you see some jittering in the beginning of September. You can now inspect that shortly before we talk about the weather, why this colony died. So we go to these six temperature sensors down. We have as an array within the hive, and here we have them as a discrete. Here we have them as a small graph panel, and we see that four of six sensors leaves the 35 degrees at the beginning of September, and the last two are leaving at like 3 weeks later. And 3 weeks is exactly the time eggs need to evolve from an egg to be a newborn. So it's the assumption is quite obvious that somehow the queen must have died or got away from the hive at the beginning of September. The rest of the colony kept the air conditionings for the brood, but there was no reason to keep the 35 degrees on after that. And the very much decline in weight tells us that there has to be some robbery happen. So let's look at the weather, and let's first have a look at the weight as an timetable. I really like that view of this heat map, this panel. Let me look at the name. It was a carpet plot plugin by Petri Slavočinek, and you can see the red stuff in the morning. That's like when the bees drop off. You really see like the weight is decreasing when the bees drop off, and they increase when they bring in honey again. And there's some kind of a we think like probably a second lift off, or maybe some other action, like some flying school probably, or maybe just it's just in siesta at the mid of the day or in the afternoon. So when talking about the weather conditions, we can for example see on the big scale like probably here must be some decline of conditions or nothing good, and we can now see here and below the elements I talked before, temperature, sun, rain and wind, that around that time we had very low temperatures. So that's kind of okay that there hasn't been much income in that period. So and now you can easily use that to inspect certain moments, like probably here when I said here must be this siesta time, and this siesta time has some gaps on 15th, 16th June. And now let's zoom in on that time. You see, yeah, the weight increased, but not that much than the other days. But we can clearly see there was on the first day at the afternoon very much wind. It was too windy for the bees, and we can indicate that the temperatures weren't that good. And when you look at the temperatures outside, yep, we are coming from 30 degrees to 20 degrees on the next day. That's obviously maybe a bit fishy for the bees too. So Let me see if I have set everything to the B dashboard I wanted to tell. Yeah. So let's look at a small another project within that context where we try to calculate the amount of eggs laid by the queen because there are some familiar which is oriented at the maximum daily temperature. So we can assume how many eggs have been laid or born until yet. It would be nice to get an idea about the whole population. There we have some data issues in calculating mortality and blending that again with our results from that calculation. See if there something happens. So, and one research is like thermal imaging, and here we use the SVG plugin to modify some SVG squares with the current array of like these 144 pixels or something like this. And when we now scroll in time by that dashboard, we can see at least as a proof of concept small things happening. Another interesting tree would be, of course, audio. This is a first step done by D-Rain on representing like the sound, which could probably indicate the appearance of the queen, or if a swarm event will take place very soon. These are definitely things one can gather from the audio data. So far for the bees. So now let's talk about the particulate matter world. When I joined the B project, there was already done by Andreas the importer for the Luftdatenpunkt-Info project, which is a hobby project where they have thousands of sensors deployed all over the world. But these sensors aren't professional ones. They have misreadings, so it's interesting to compare them with the official readings in bigger sensors. That's like the import for Belgium of the hobby low-cost sensors. And when we did that, someone after the Belgian Environmental Agency approached us and said, "You've written a nice importer for the Luftdateninfodaten, or it's now called sensor.community. Would you like to run it at ours too?" And we said, "Yes, of course." And you know what? You definitely to want to have a look into Grafana and what you can do there too, like on compensating probably some errors there. And they said, "Okay, well, show us." So I have the honor to show that now to you. These are like the two worlds. We have on the left the very, very expensive several thousand devices and several thousand money buildings where they are located, and on the right the 20 bucks sensors developed for air conditioning systems and a very cheap housing compared to the rest. And the sensor itself is by the manufacturer designed like just to work until humidity is around 70-80%, which we will address later on. So to have to make a good side-by-side comparison, of course you need to have the data, and so Andreas wrote as an importer for the sensor observation service, which is in standard from the Open Geospatial Consortium, to import the data of the Belgium official readings. So and now we have like the base to make and just compare views across both networks, and that's like our landing page where you have both networks ISO welcome, and you can click either on one of the left or on the right to open up a compare dashboard. Because these compare dashboards need to have one ID as a start. There's like the master dashboard on the for the one network and the sister dashboard for the other network. Which starts from the other ID and looks up the other IDs and the other networks starting from there. So we have to do a parallel development of the dashboards. So we just pick up one official station here and now get the dashboard loaded where we can see first compare views. We have like on the top some calendaric view with like the total exceedance and see like do we match more or less the same days for exceeding the thresholds. We see that too is in that carpet stripe, I would say. And we have on the left the scatter plot where we see on the top axis the low cost sensor readings and on the other axis like the official, and we see in the color the humidity at the point when the sample was taken, and we see like red the high humidities that these red points are above the 1-to-1 line. But in general, these readings, well, we see here are probably a bit below the official readings. Here we have in the background the humidity, and as a small gray line, oh, let me show it to you full, the ratio between the official and the low-cost reading. And of course, perfect world would be one, but now you see it's mainly less, but in events of high humidity, we are sometimes above. So we can just use that again to open like another pair and compare that again. So that's the comparison, that's the comparison view. Let's now go over to the question on compensation. The bias of the low-cost sensor is quite obvious because it's a laser scatter sensor and detects everything as a particle which is in the way of light, and so vapor particles, water in the air at high moistures, at high humidities is detected too. Regular stuff deals with that the air is preheated before it reaches the sensor, so that all the water molecules are more or less dense. And the capability of storing water is higher for the air. But that's not practiced with the low-cost sensor network. So we have to fall back to the assumption that at high humidities we need to compensate and reduce the value. And from the data we have seen, they are obviously underestimates too. So we want to compare with humidity. Let's first have a look at the humidities we have available. We look at the low-cost sensor network. There are two types of sensors, the more cheap DHT22 and the more advanced BME280. Now let's just have a rough look for, let's use German data, or for the official humidity readings from the weather service and these two types of hobby sensors. And we see that readings from around 100% are very rare, but they are right now within our current weather situations, like 3-4% of the official stations are giving a reading of 100% humidity. Now we look at the BME280 sensor and of the Luftdateninfo network, and we see like a quarter is giving a reading around 100%. And when we look at the very cheap sensor, we see more than half is giving a high reading of 100%, and it's important for us to get these high readings accurately because that's then where we need to do the compensation. And when we now look, this cheapo sensor is like used 70% of the time. We said ourselves, nope, let's lose the official data and do a lookup of the nearest station in the official network, which has a humidity reading, not everyone there, too. So we are doing, in fact, two lookups in the background or later on a third for the wind direction. And to find the closest station in the other network, we found some lags within influx to do so. So we're using our PostGIS for our metadata, and there's we can use there for our variable like this query to get the nearest station in the other network, where we get from the first network just the longitude and latitude with another variables now reused again to query in this new variable the closest station in the other network. So now let's talk a bit about how we do the actual compensation of the data within influx itself. There are two queries. The first, getting the particulate matter data, stores that into one table. The second gets the humidity data, stores it into another table. And then we do a join on these two tables and can create a new value. And now with the power of every math function you can believe, at least implemented within Go language, and now create some correction of that. And we have here some factors from the formula, which can be even substituted with a variable, a dashboard template variable too. So let's look at this correction dashboard in action. Like here we have where we have been before, so a small link like to some correction views, and we now use the chakrabarti fitted. Yeah. Let me click on it. Yeah. And it loads the station, so shows where these two compared stations are located. This is a test setup, they're very close to each other. See where our humidity station, our next wind station is. We see here the formula which is applied, and A and B are variables as set. So I can have here the variables of our dashboard and tinker like and change like B probably to 0.3. And then we have some recalculations. You see here now a third line, the black one is now the corrected version, and it has just changed to a new appliance of this formula. On the left, we see the laser scatter, the scatter plot again, and below the scatter plot again for the corrected readings. And now we can see that these high humidity readings, which have been read here, are now more below our one-to-one line. So we are like maybe compensating too much, and we have like our maximum growth factor limit, and we could maybe change that from 1.5 to 1.25. And then eventually these red points will move up a bit. So we have our ratios here again, and now of both the raw readings and the corrected readings, they should be close to one, and now we can see which one is better. And in green you see this correction factor depending on the humidity in the background. So then we have here histogram view, so we can see this is a raw re this is the official reading, that's a raw reading, and our correction now moves at least a bit within that scope, but not perfect. So, and I would like to talk a bit about the Windrose plugin, which is I think a very very nice plugin for this use case. On the first you see a simple two-dimension view, where you see just the concentration of particles per wind direction, and on the right, so and you see mainly like no particles are coming mainly from that direction. Okay, it's interesting, but these high readings, like 115 particles, you see only a small red point here. Now we can combine that with the third axis in the scatter plot view of this plugin, where we can use the wind speed too. And sorry, there's some rendering bugs. Yes, on this scale, written micrograms that have to be meters per second because of the wind speed. And now the size of the circle represents the amount of particles, the PM2.5 reading. So we can now clearly see that there must be a big pollutant for particulate matter in that direction. And there must be some in that, but not that big. And you can probably get an idea if there would be some pollutant closer to you or more far away. So that's so far this part, and I would like to end with some ideas and wishes. First thing, as you have seen, I'm very much into FluxLang, the new InfluxDB query language. And the support for FluxLang is not enough. We still lack some support in alerting or in the map panel or when creating variable requests within the templating. And another idea I would really love to see is more support for tooltips in every plugin, especially in the map plugin. Imagine like you hover over a graph, and all the points in the map change to the time, to the timestamp where you're currently hovering, so you can have a really wibbly wobbly map while you're just moving your mouse over your data. And I think that can, if it doesn't crash the browser, create a very great user experience when looking at data. And one idea was, if you just open it up, we have a minute. Seen correction with one formula. There are several formulas available, and now our colleagues in Belgium have to look out which formula, what parameters might be good. We have here a dashboard with like the other correction formula, bring it bigger, or the Köhler formula, or the Sonnier formula, and we have all here corrections on the right from every formula of that station set. And here in the top, you see the big amount of variables we have. It would be very great to lock these variables in some plugin and some panel, and put this panel for these relevant variables here closer to the area where I'm using them. So, I will say thank you for listening if you reached so far. There should follow up some question and answers now. I'm interested how that will work out. You can drop me an email every time or come to our Hive-Eyes forum. We have a community discourse forum where you can say hello, and I think we will help you there if you like to. So, and one last word about the slides. I think there will be sort of two versions, like the dynamic interactive version. You have seen that presentation is a website, and we have iframes from thousands of hosts, which might be offline in some time. And maybe there may be the more static version with screenshots of what I've just shown to you. So I say thanks and goodbye, and hope you found that good too. Bye.